equilateral, trapezoid, isosceles, tetrahedron.
I have never seen a mind like the one your daughter has. You have to see what she becomes.
Come on!
Catherine, we all gonna end up unemployed riding around in this pile of junk.
You're welcome to walk the 16 mile.
Or sit in the back of the bus.
You have identification on?
We're just on our way to work at NASA, sir.
I had no idea they hired.
There are quite a few women working in the space program.
You know what we're doing here? We're putting a human on top of a missile, shooting them into space, and it's never been done before. I need a mathematician that can look beyond the numbers. Math that doesn't yet exist. Before the Russians plant a flag on the damn moon.
You have someone? Running toward
our plans. Catherine's the gal for that. She can handle any numbers you put in front of her.
Don't embarrass me.
This wasn't emptied last night.
I'm sorry, I'm not the...
That Colonel Jim is a tall glass of water.
He's coming over.
Now, why would he be doing that?
Because Mary's waving at him.
No!
Dorothy, slice of pie?
I'd love one.
You already have a slice of pie, Dorothy. Oh,
left. You're a computer at NASA. They let women handle that sort of...
Yes, it's an uphill battle.
Yes, they let women do some things at NASA, Mr. Johnson.
And it's not because we wear skirts.
It's because we wear glasses.
We go from being our father's daughters to our husband's wives to our baby's mothers.
You've been gone for 300 hours.
Was Mama gone for 12 and a half days?
No, but it felt like it.
It felt like it to me, too.
It's crunch time. In 14 days, astronauts will be here for training. Everything we do can matter to their wives, to their children. I believe it's going to matter to the whole damn country.
My gals are ready. We can do the work.
That's John Glenn.
What do you ladies do for NASA?
Calculate
launch and landing, sir. Engineering. And I'm proud as the devil to be working with you.
How could you possibly be ogling these white men?
It's equal rights. I have the right to see fine in Africa.
There's no protocol for women attending.
There's no protocol for a man circling the earth either, sir.
Every time we have a chance to get ahead, they move the finish line. Every time.
We all get there together, or we don't get there at all.
It's good to know NASA hadn't given up on good old-fashioned brain power.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Let me ask you, if you were a white male, would you wish to be an engineer?
I wouldn't have to. I'd already be one.
Don't you know that we're able?
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Margot Lee Shetterly, the author of Hidden Figures, The American Dream, and the untold story of the black women mathematicians who helped win the space race. John Donvan is back to lead the conversation.
So when stories slip from consciousness and turn into films, very often they first have life as a book, and they have to have writers. But before there are writers, they have to have finders. And Margot, you are the writer, but more importantly, you are the finder, the refinder of this story. Congratulations.
Thank you.
On what
very
you've
much.
Done here. Let's, because I know that your connection to this story actually connects to your life and your biography, let's start with where you grew up and who you are.
Mm-hmm. So I grew up in Hampton, Virginia, which is also the place where the first aeronautical laboratory that would eventually become NASA was founded during World War I.
What were they doing there?
They were doing research on airplanes. Mm-hmm. So, you know, today we think of NASA and we think of Mars, like the presentation we had this morning. But NASA, what would become NASA, got its start doing research on airplanes at the time when that was the cutting edge technology. And that was happening in Hampton, Virginia. Which is where I'm from, and my dad is he's now retired, but he's a research scientist, an atmospheric scientist, who spent his entire career there at the Langley Research Center.
And how did you then, through the connection with your father, through the connection with this community, discover what you call in your title the hidden figures? Double entendre.
Exactly. So I think I rediscovered them, or I got a chance to see them, a different aspect of them. So a lot of these women worked with my father. You know, as a little kid, I'd go out to visit my dad at his office, and, you know, I'd see them there. And it didn't occur to me at the time to wonder why there were so many women there working at NASA, why there were black women working there with my dad. And it wasn't until a trip home 6 years ago when I was there with my husband, and my dad was talking about the women, some of the women that he worked with, the mathematicians, the work they had done, calculating trajectories, doing aeronautical research. And my husband was the one who said, I can't believe that I've never heard this story. So for me, it was a moment of seeing the place and the people that I knew growing up through an outside, with an outsider's perspective, and realizing that, you know, one, this was an interesting story, and two, I really didn't know the half of it, but I wanted to.
So you weren't surprised that these women were there, but you realized through your husband that the rest of the world might be surprised by it.
That the rest of the world might be surprised, and that those of us who did know that story hadn't really valued the women or the work that they had done, or had the enough information to really put them in the correct historical perspective.
So you decided to do the story. What did you do then?
Well, you know, every story, I feel like I'm the end of the story. You know, I'm you know, the result of, you know, a successful aeronautical or atmospheric research scientist and an English professor who went to Hampton University, which is the historically black university that basically incubated the women who went on to become mathematicians at NASA. So what I had to do was get to the beginning of the story. I started with Katherine Johnson, who, that's a name that many people may recognize. She was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom last year, 2015. And she, particularly in Hampton Roads, where I'm from, she is somebody whose name people have known for many decades. But really, it was through my conversations with her that I started hearing other names, like Dorothy Vaughan, you know, that I sort of figured out how to look through the notes of NASA research reports to find that there, in fact, were many women over the years, including black women, who had been doing really high-level research and were credited on these reports and, you know, had simply sort of faded into the distance, you know, with the years. So it really was sort of a scavenger hunt, or, you know, tracking down a mystery of sorts, because I didn't know where the story began, and that process took 3 years.
Where did you have to travel?
Let's see. So I traveled to Farmville, Virginia tonight, where the debate's happening tonight. Dorothy Vaughan, the first woman that I write about in the book, worked at Moton High School, which is notable because there was a student strike in 1951 against the deplorable conditions in their segregated school that eventually was rolled up into the Brown versus Board of Education court case outlawing school segregation in the U.S. So Farmville, Virginia, White Sulphur Springs, West Virginia was another place that I went. That's where Katherine Johnson was born. Archives from Texas to Philadelphia to Washington, D.C. Basically, any time I got an inkling of anything that would help me to sort of learn more about this story, I went there.
So let's go back to the when the organization that they worked for was the predecessor to NASA, I think.
The National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics.
1943 was when the women went to work?
1943, during World War II.
What did they do during World War II? What did they do at that center?
So this was a really big moment for the United States, you know, and for these women and for the aeronautics industry. The President Roosevelt had just ordered the production of 50,000 planes a year, which sounds like nothing to us today, but at that time, you know, seemed like an impossible task for the industry to fulfill. And but with that came the need for people who could understand the aeronautics of the plane, understand how to make it fly faster, more efficiently, how to make it safer, how to keep it from rolling, you know. So they would do two things. One is affix instruments to the planes and fly them, and basically measure every aspect of its performance.
Just by trial and error, then?
By trial and error, and but over time, you know, they had more and more information and were able to do a more sophisticated job of...
But it was all empirical. They weren't, because they couldn't create computer models.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. No, this was fly the plane, get the data, and,
fix it.
Exactly. Yeah. But then they would park the planes or plane parts in wind tunnels, and they would observe how the air flew over, how it passed over the plane, doing, you know, essentially the same thing, but on the ground. So out of this testing came numbers, the same kind of data that we, you know, use in basically every aspect of our lives or technology. This is what came forth, these numbers. And so the computers, which today we rely on, these electronic devices that are in our toasters and, you know, absolutely everything in our life, these women were the computers, and in fact, that was their job title.
That puzzled me when I was reading the book. I had to read the first few times I came across the word computers. The computers were here, the computers were there. I didn't at first catch that they were talking about people.
A computer is someone who computes, and it was usually a woman. The same way a writer writes.
Yeah.
You know, a computer was a person who computed, and she usually wore a skirt.
Yeah. I mean, there was one group called the West Computers, and I kept looking for the West Computer Company, but they were the computer people, and they were the people who compute in the West part of the facility. Basically.
Yeah, exactly. And in fact, the West Computer, so this, we have to remember the story took place in Virginia, and Jim Crow segregation was still very much in effect. The East Computing Pool, which was located on the older east part of the Langley campus, and this is Langley in Hampton, Virginia, not Langley to be confused with CIA in Northern Virginia, mm-hmm. but on the east part of the campus, the white women, the white computers, worked in that office, in that pool, and when the black women came, well, they needed to have a segregated office. They put them on in an office in the newer west section, and they were known as, on the org chart, as the West Computers, but more colloquially as the colored computers, to use the language of the day.
And if I'm picturing what they did, is it slide rules and scratching numbers, or were they using adding machines? What did they actually do to compute?
Well, a number of things. They did use slide rules. They had these big desktop calculating machines, which they used for addition, multiplication, subtraction, division. If you were able to do square roots, I mean, that came along later. That was a machine that you really coveted. Mm-hmm. And they would fill, an engineer would assign them, because the engineers were the ones who made the assignments of what kind of work was to be done. The engineer assigned them, for example, an equation describing the pressure distribution over a wing. And they would then be required to take all of the numbers that had come from the test, plug them into the equations, and, you know, work out the numbers. This is, you can think of these women sitting in the room as performing the function of an Excel spreadsheet. You know, we set up the spreadsheet, we set up mm-hmm. the equations, we have the data, you know, the spreadsheet goes through the calculations and you get output. All of this work was done by hand by these women with their pencils, their slide rules, and their calculating machines.
Was it higher mathematics then, or was it fairly routine sort of mathematics? Was it a kind of mechanical arithmetic?
It really varied. I mean, there were women who did do just, you know, working the machines, as they called it. But there were quite a few women who were actually using, doing very high-level theoretical mathematics. So the same thing that some of the engineers would, you know, they would use flight tests, so actually flying real planes to get answers. Some of them used the wind tunnels to get answers to fixing the planes, and others of them used theoretical mathematics to in search of those same answers.
And, you know, I think that people like your husband and others would be surprised, because the narrative of the time would be that African Americans would not be respected enough, even coming out of a university, to be getting a job in the government when there's positions available for whites, and yet those jobs opened up. What was going on at the time? Is it just the matter that math is math, and if you're good at it, you're good at it?
I think that's a certain part of it. But really, it was the rubber meeting the road of World War II. men overall went off to the front to fight, and so we know this was a time when all women, there was an opening for all women to come into these jobs. And then the thing that really pushed it, you know, pushed the ball over the goal line for these African-American women was that there was a civil rights leader whose name has also been largely lost to us these days, named A. Philip Randolph, who was the head of the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters, which was the largest black labor union in the country. And these were the men who attended guests on trains that crisscrossed the country. And he essentially pressured President Roosevelt to open what had the civil service, which had been segregated under Woodrow Wilson, to African Americans. So 2 years after that executive order, and about a year and a half after Pearl Harbor, the first five black women walked through the door at the Langley Laboratory in Hampton, Virginia.
Well, I think everyone knows from the clip of the movie, which we'll get to because I'm sure that some stuff gets made up by Hollywood. Nevertheless, they know that John Glenn is in the story. Mm-hmm. They know that the exploration of space is in the story. So obviously, some of these women rose through the ranks.
They did.
Where did they get to?
Where they got to was eventually was the moon.
Wow.
not to spoil the story, but you know, Americans eventually
well,
do make it
home.
To the moon.
Yes.
So Katherine Johnson, she's well known, as we know in the movie, takes place around this very exciting time in 1962 when the U.S. has fallen behind in the space race. And John Glenn, who goes on to become a hero because he eventually is the astronaut on a successful orbital flight, leaving the Earth, going around the Earth, and coming back home safely. Katherine Johnson was the human computer who was on the job, who was responsible for the research report that did the math describing the trajectory, exactly, you know, how this craft on this rocket is going to leave the Earth and then come back. And then she also did a lot of the math that was involved in the sort of ballet between the crafts on the moon, like getting to the moon, dropping the lander, and having it come back.
And in the time she was doing this, did she get to get credit for what she was doing, or was she in the situation where she is in a back room doing the work and it was sent forward and there was no sense that this is Katherine Johnson's work?
You know what? It was both. You know, the thing that I really noticed, not just with her, but in looking at all of the other women, you know, that were working there at the time, you know, there was certainly a lot of institutional prejudice and racism. There's no question. If you have to go to the colored girls' bathroom, you know, while you're doing the calculations for the astronauts, you know, that is institutional discrimination. But, you know, it is also true that women of all backgrounds existed in the blind spots of these engineers, you know, and if a woman was, you know, capable of doing the work and wanted to do the work, she really had to raise her hand and basically demand to be allowed into the meeting rooms where these, you know, where the research was being discussed. That's what Katherine Johnson did. So Katherine Johnson actually, when she co-authored the report, basically spelling out how this orbital flight was going to take place, mm-hmm. 1959, she got her name on that research report.
Which was a big deal.
Which is a huge deal. You know, this is a huge deal. But she insisted, and she insisted, and she insisted until finally...
Did she meet resistance when insisting?
She absolutely met resistance. She said, listen, I want to go to these editorial meetings where you guys are discussing my numbers. And the engineer said, well, you know, women aren't allowed to go to the meetings. You know, why? You're a woman. Why would you want to go to the meetings? They're not allowed. And she insisted, and finally they said, great, you know, just come on into the meetings. And that is the reason why she was able to get her name on those research reports. She was in the room where it happens, to paraphrase a certain very popular theater performance.
I want to go to questions in just a second. But before that, one more point. You make a very subtle point in the book about the fact that you have, I would say, to some degree, rescued these women from general obscurity for being distinct and special. And yet you argue the point is not that they were distinct and special. You say something like, you know, I don't want to just have the impression that all of these people were the first and onlys. What is your argument there? What are you saying?
Well, the thing about it is, we never question the motivations of the Chris Crafts or the Gene Kranzes or the Neil Armstrongs and their interest in this math and science, or their capability, you know, their ability to do the work and then some. You know, we take that for granted. That's what these women want. You know, they want that the same way that their white male counterparts. They love the engineering. They're good at the engineering.
They wanted their extraordinariness to be ordinary?
They wanted their extraordinariness to be ordinary, just like everyone else. They didn't want to stand out because they were women or because they were black. They wanted to fit in because they were talented and because they were the right people for the job. I think that's what all of us want.
And came up with the right numbers.
They came up with the right numbers. The numbers don't lie.
Questions?
Good afternoon. Tony Irving, Executive Director at Get in Chicago. Margot Lee, I just want to let you know that, like all the alum at Virginia, we are all extremely proud of you and excited about the film, so rah, rah. But also, just from the energy of people in the room where it's very entrepreneurial, I'd love to hear more about your own process. You talked about just stumbling back into the story, but really about the process of getting your text recognized, bringing it to print, and the print becoming a film, and more of just that journey.
Hi, it's great to see Tony and I went to school together, so it's this is really wonderful to see her here. Well, I would say, you know, one of the things for me writing this book is a lot of the women started off with one career and they ended up doing something totally different. You know, they thought because, basically because they were women, they loved math, that they would be teachers. Mm-hmm. And then they found this whole career of being professional mathematicians. And so I sympathize with that because, you know, I started my career as an investment banker. I worked in startup businesses for many years, worked as an entrepreneur. And so one of the things that became clear to me is that in addition to being a writer, writing a book is sort of also a very entrepreneurial endeavor. And particularly, I mean, I've learned so much because the two processes of turning this history into a manuscript and then turning that manuscript into a book and then having the book turned into a movie has sort of like required every entrepreneurial instinct, you know, that I've had to sort of keep all of these processes on track at the same time. So for me, it's been wonderful because I've enjoyed the writing and the research as much as anything that I've ever done. But it was also sort of gratifying to feel like I'm still an entrepreneur in terms of bringing Hidden Figures to fruition.
Mm-hmm. For real. Another question?
Hi, my name is Alicia Ekman. I am a student at Iowa State University studying aerospace engineering. So first off, thank you for telling these stories of the women in NASA back in the day. I think that's an incredibly important story to tell. My question is about the movie, actually. Do you have any concerns about the dramatization of your story, or is it just all happy thoughts?
Well, I think it's hard because, you know, the book is, it's like my baby, you know. The book, it covers three decades of history, and I think rightly the producers decided to condense that down to basically, this very exciting time period. That year of 1962 around John Glenn's flight. So understanding that the book and the film are different media was difficult for me at first, mm-hmm. but you know, I've learned a lot about that. I guess my biggest concern is that it is a very big, exciting Hollywood movie. And you know, I think a lot of the details, obviously you cannot put all of those details of the book in the movie. But I want people, a lot of people, because of that, because it's big and shiny, I think that they think that it's actually not true.
Really?
That is, I've had a lot of sort of people who've gotten in touch with me because they think that the movie, that this what's being shown in the movie is not true because it just seems so improbable or so big and dramatic and I don't know, but you know, I just hope, I want people to really understand that this is a true story. These women exist, you know, they did this work, and, You know, there are, you know, almost 1,000 footnotes in the back of the book dedicated to documenting this and making sure that everyone understands
so
that.
So I think the best answer to people who doubt the veracity of the movie is to say, read the book.
It's simple.
Read the book.
Read the book.
It's called Hidden Figures. It is spectacular. Thank you, everybody, and thank you, Margot.
Thank you.
Thanks.